All right, it is October the 17th, 2012. This is Thomas Keegan, your host for this interview today with LibertarianProgressive.com, where you will find the largest compilation of original interviews of independent third-party candidates who are going to be on the ballots this November 6th, 2012. We're running against Republicans and Democrats. If you want to know more of your choices, that's a place where you can find over 53 interviews of independent third-party candidates running for the U.S. Congress all around our country. And today we are talking with and interviewing Scott Jesty. It's running for U.S. Congress, and he's running in the at-large in Delaware. He's running against Bernard August, a Green Party candidate, John Carney Jr., the Democrat, and Thomas Kovach, the Republican. So John Carney Jr. is the incumbent, and the incumbent who I want to let you know, I mean, he voted for the two provisions of the National Defense Authorization Act. Basically, it's a vote against the Constitution. He voted for that saying, I don't want you to have due process. I want American citizens to be able to be... picked up by the military police on U.S. soil and not know the charges, the accusers, be held indefinitely, basically Soviet style. So he took an oath, but I think that's a direct violation. So Scott's running, and here's a chance for some change. A lot of people say we have to change the paradigm first, but I believe the paradigm has changed. Congress has a 10% approval rating, which they've had consistently about this whole year, and probably less than 20% for like about the last decade. So, Scott, thank you for joining us. Thank you for being able to, stand the heat, be in the kitchen, have questions thrown your way, talk about the real issues that we won't hear. Be on the ballot to be in position in case people want to vote for someone who's going to be representative of them. Can you please tell us, sir, in opening here, what got you motivated and a little bit about, a little bit about Delaware and just a little bit about yourself, sir, and thanks for joining us today.
Sure, and first, thank you very much for giving me the opportunity to talk with you today. Being a third-party candidate, and it seems especially here in Delaware, we just don't seem to get the attention, that we deserve, in my opinion. And so it's exciting to be here and having this interview with you and talking about, as you said, some of the issues that aren't really being talked about here in this state. I decided to run for Congress. It wasn't something that I had planned to do for a long time. When we had our convention, we didn't have anybody standing up to be federal candidates. I thought, given the strength of the Libertarian Party ticket with Gary Johnson and Judge Gray and all the positive attention that the Libertarian Party had received through the two presidential runs of Texas Congressman Ron Paul, it just simply wasn't acceptable to not have somebody from the Libertarian Party, on the ballot in the state to offer the constituents here, the choice of somebody who is really different than the status quo. So I decided to run because it was something I felt that needed to be done. I have no interest in being a long-term career politician, but I mean, to your point with Congress's approval rating so low, and to be quite frank, to major party candidates in this state that really don't have a lot of big differences between them. I was at a debate that we were not allowed to participate in last night at the University of Delaware, and it really wasn't a debate. It was really like a joint press conference. They both agree that we need to keep taxes on the table. We shouldn't decrease taxes.
An infomercial. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. They believe, we should continue to police the world. We should continue to take our directions from our counterparts in the United Nations, and they both agree. I mean, how many times has Congress so far repealed Obamacare since it's been passed? 31, 33. We have a Republican candidate running that says he won't do that. He's going to take the moderate position, and he thinks that repeal is a waste of time and tweak it around the edges. And I just don't think that's the choice that you know, the people of Delaware want. I mean, why just go in and choose Coke or Pepsi? I mean, we need to have somebody who...
Well, you're forced to choose Coke and Pepsi with Obamacare. I mean, you have to choose, some private insurance that you might not want. You might prefer catastrophic insurance. That's what I would usually prefer, and they won't allow it with this. Some businesses are exempt, some are not. You're mandated to buy from a private company. I mean, how corrupt can that be? I mean, that's like the mafia saying, give me your money. I mean, you know, if they want to force me to buy, you know, some insurance from companies that I don't really have any faith in, then shouldn't I be able to force them to buy my products so I can use that revenue to buy their insurance with? I mean, it's really silly, and it's unconstitutional. I mean, now they're forcing us to buy from private companies.
Oh, it's
just
ridiculous.
To be alive. I mean, you don't have to even have a car. I mean, you don't have a choice to be alive, you know?
Mm-hmm. Oh, absolutely. It's ridiculous that the federal government is forcing us to buy any product. And I agree with you that it's unconstitutional. I don't particularly care, you know, what the Supreme Court says with regards to the individual mandate. The entire bill should have been struck down. I'm the only candidate in Delaware that says we should repeal it outright, completely. You know, the few good things that are in it, you know, Congress does have the right to regulate commerce. We can stop insurance companies from discriminating against people who have pre-existing conditions. If the state really wants children to be able to stay on their parents' policy till they're 26 years old, okay, we can do that. But, you know, to force people, you know, into these exchanges and purchase insurance, as you said, you know, from you know, corrupt insurance companies or other companies that, you know, we normally wouldn't do business with, that's not right, and I don't support that.
Yeah, you can imagine a lot. The precedent. I mean, this is a precedent for a lot of things. What if the insurance that you're forced to buy from says, or what if they all pooled together and said, okay, for anyone to buy insurance through us because we have to keep costs down, we require you to just get, you know, this little microchip in you that has all your health statistics and data. That way, you know, if you ever get put in a hospital or something, we can bring up your information. It's going to save time. It's going to save money. And if you don't get it, you're part of the problem. Or you know, you have to take these certain vaccines. You have to do this and that. It's corporate tyranny and it's fascism mixing corporation and state. It's Delaware is at large, so I mean, there's, you know, one district. We did interview Andrew Groff there, who's running for Senate in the Green Party, who's also endorsed by the Libertarians, and maybe for, you know, some of that endorsement, you might get some support this way, I suppose, maybe, who knows. So we can either have Romney Care or Obamacare, no matter what you call it. It's a wolf in sheep's clothing. And so any other issues that didn't come up at that, kind of fake debates that you attended the other day?
Well, one of the most annoying things that occurred during the debate was the discussion on foreign policy. Not only are my opponents, you know, completely ignorant to, you know, our foreign policy problems, but they're also completely clueless with regards to, you know, how we should commit our servicemen and women around the world into combat. I mean, both of them pretty much agreed that we need to be very careful and we need to pick and choose, you know, where we go very carefully, and we have to watch what dictators we prop up, and, you know, we need to consult with our United Nations allies and things of that nature. And they were talking about boots on the ground. The question was, you know, when do we have boots on the ground? And they said these things, and I was sitting there shaking my head. I said, well, how about we put boots on the ground only when the President of the United States addresses a joint session of Congress, presents to the American people the threat to our national security, explains why we need to go in and put our men and women in danger, and ask for a formal declaration of war? That never even crossed their minds, you know, when they talked about this question. We are currently, right now, involved on the ground with having our men and women getting shot at and shooting at people in 75 different countries around the world on a daily basis. Daily. That's unacceptable, And it's something that's very important to me, it's very important to my family, and I think it's something, you know, we're going to try to expose these people. I will be in a debate next week, at the Widener University of Law here in Wilmington, and I'm really hoping the question comes up because it's something that needs to be addressed.
Well, that'll be like a chance for the electorate to be more educated and informed what Thomas Jefferson suggested pleaded and for the electorate, for, you know, democracy to work, to have a fully informed and educated public. And also that kind of goes to spending. They all want, you know, we have to be careful, we have to be prudent, we have to stand firm. I mean, these are all like little cliches that anyone can say. And if you don't, I guess you haven't met a certain threshold. But and they don't want to talk about cutting any spending whatsoever. I mean, they're just arguing over who raises spending a little bit less. Military spending, I mean, Gary Johnson suggesting we go back to 2003 levels, which kind of cuts our military budget by 43%, 2003 levels, which was pretty high. I mean, that was at the steep of, the Iraq War and stuff. What do you think, our military budget should look like, if you had to be, somewhat specific? I know it's a big budget and you can't get into all the details probably until you see it, but what are your thoughts or opinions, or do you have any facts or figures that you could kind of put as, kind of a tentative plan or something that's, your kind of thought process on that?
Well, I my thought process around that is we definitely need to, look at all spending when it comes to the budget. And the military spending and our defense budget is certainly not off the table, as many of our Republicans in Congress currently say. I mean, we have, in 2011, we spent $711 billion on defense, and that doesn't account for the amount of money that we spent bribing other nations or, giving them money to do what we say to do. We certainly need to cut it, I agree.
Or supplemental budgets. I mean, they're probably spending twice that much.
Yeah. I mean, that's just what they'll admit, that they're spending. So you're right. I mean, $711 billion is just what's on paper. It's probably more. It's probably, getting up to around $1 trillion a year. And it needs to be cut. And I agree with Gary Johnson's figures, around 40-50% we could cut, and I'm confident we could still have a very strong military. And the way to take those cuts in is we stop policing the world. We concentrate on the national defense, not the national offense.
Well, just saying that, you said something revolutionary. That's the first significant cuts you'll probably hear in any debate. I mean, that just by itself, I'm not saying that's the only place, of course, but I'm just trying to point out one big area that's probably going to be more cuts and make a significant impact to the budget than anything we've done probably since, I don't know when, probably Eisenhower or something, when we cut after World War II or something. I mean, that's we've never actually had any cuts, I don't think, for like the last 50 years or something.
Well, it certainly is the low-hanging fruit, in my opinion, where you can save hundreds of billions of dollars pretty quickly, still have a strong national defense, still support our troops, and, even if you cut it down to like $400 billion a year, you're still outspending China by a couple hundred billion, and you're spending as much as probably the top, number two to number six behind us, so all combined. I mean, we currently spend, that amount of money that I mentioned is, 48% of the entire military budget spent on the entire globe.
Yeah, so, I mean, I think we'd still spend like as much as like the top other five, or somewhere between 5 to 10 combined, that's including Russia, China, Germany, and Japan, and some other countries. So I mean, we'd still like be able to spend more than all of those people still combined, pretty much. And and the consequences, what do you think should be, like, how should we deal with Millie? Should we just ignore it? Should we try to trade? Do you think we could trade? We trade with China, who's, like, supposed to be, someone we could go to war over with, but we trade a lot of money with them, and that's probably one reason why we might not go to war with them. I mean, do you think it's possible to do that to the, you know, uncivilized people in the Middle East, as, and I say that with a pun intended, because that's how they say it, usually.
Yeah, I'm glad you said it was a pun, because, you know, I don't believe the people in the Middle East are uncivilized. I think, they value their religious beliefs very, very strongly, probably a little strongly than, well, not probably, they do, more strongly than we do here and other places around the world. But it's not like they're uncivilized. I mean, they're angry, and they're directing their anger at the West because we've been involved in their business for how many decades now?
Well, since World War II, I mean, since we needed the oil for that war, yeah.
Yeah, so absolutely. So, you know, when you have outside powers influencing your political leaders, influencing what's going on in your country, I mean, of course you're going to get angry, and they're angry at us, and they're angry at us because we're involved. So, you know, if we would disengage from that, and we would stop, foreign aid, not just to Israel, but to all the other countries in the Middle East, let them work out their own problems, they'd be glad to sell us their oil. I'm certain that, you know, the oil and OPEC countries aren't sitting there saying, man, we really hate to take the money from the Americans.
Yeah, and plus they would still have to compete with, like, Brazil, Russia, and amongst themselves. I mean, there would still be competition that would motivate them to sell us oil. We probably would have gotten it cheaper. Who knows?
Oh, absolutely. So, I mean, we can definitely trade with other countries, but if there's countries that, you know, are doing things that, you know, we don't think is appropriate around the world, or they're not acting the way, there's nothing that says we have to do business with them, but there's also nothing that says we have to try to pay them to stop acting the way they are and act the way we tell them to do, and there's absolutely nothing there that says we have to go bomb these people. So, you know, we should take the approach that we should be friends with as many people as we can, we should trade openly with them, we should stay out of other people's business, and if we take this route, well, I think we'll be safer, the world would be a lot more prosperous, and things would be a lot better.
Yeah, a lot of countries like Americana, I mean, we'd probably, you know, possibly have some, you know, maybe have some even trade, not no deficits, trade deficits with them. Maybe we would have a surplus. Who knows? I don't know. But they do have a lot of money making oil, so, they might buy a lot of our products, you know. And the money that we buy their oil with, they'll just buy our products with. And we can get some of them in outer space so they can, you know, see the world. Some astronauts or something in the space station or something like that. But this is like revolutionary. I mean, because if you stop this, I mean, you have to know that, you know, some big companies might stop getting, you know, so many no-bid contracts and things like that. So, I mean, you might hurt some special interests.
That's probably why they're not giving me any money.
Yeah. They get money from their contracts, and they probably use like a snippet of that to try to give money to their candidates of their choice. So it is a vicious cycle. I mean, just the fact that they're getting that money, they can defer some of their other monies to supporting candidates that will support them even getting more money. And so what happens to a free market when we bail people out, when we give certain people no-bid contracts, when we make the regulations so stringent that we repress, you know, small and mid-sized competitors? I mean, what does that do to our standard of living, or, you know, the overall scene?
Oh, well, I mean, it definitely brings our standard of living down. I mean, it was reported a couple weeks ago, and it was no surprise that, you know, the middle class in this country, their wealth and their standard of living, you know, dropped in the last decade from 2000, you know, to 2009, you know, for the first time since it's ever been recorded, and that's absolutely understandable. It's a consequence of, you know, our bad business practices. It's a consequence of, you know, the Federal Reserve, you know, printing money out of thin air and, you know, giving us currency inflation and trying to set, you know, the value of money artificially instead of letting it float on the market. You know, these rules and regulations that that they're piling on as a result of Dodd-Frank is a knee-jerk reaction to try to stop future bubbles from bursting that they caused. I know from experience.
Like the dollars say, in God we trust, not the Federal Reserve we trust. I mean, you know, it says even on there, in God we trust, the Federal Reserve's not God. I mean, we shouldn't put full faith and credit in people. That's why we have different branches of government and a balance of power.
Oh, I agree. You know, the Federal Reserve banking system has a tremendous amount of power. I mean, when you have the power to, you know, print money, when you have the power to, you know, set the price of money and credit, when you have the power to divert the money to certain people or corporations or banks first, you have a tremendous amount of power over a country. So, I mean, the Federal Reserve is definitely something that needs to be looked at. I'm very excited that it's gotten a lot more attention over the last few years. I'm excited it was audited, and I think it should be audited further.
Well, one thing you could do, if you can print money infinitely, is without any auditing or anything like that, accountability, is that you could lower interest rates. And then, you know what, since I'm lowering interest rates so much, gosh, I should probably purchase a lot of, like, home lending companies and things like that, because with these lower interest rates, I know there's going to be a lot more home loans out there. And I know there's going to be a boom because I lower these interest rates. So let me tell all my friends and stuff, they can purchase all these companies. Then right before it crashes, because, you know, that's just predictable, we can sell it all off. And then after that, we can just purchase everything for pennies on the dollar.
Well, you'd think that, but, you know, I'd have to challenge that a little bit, because I agree, if you give the money to the banks for virtually nothing and then they loan it out at a low interest rate, they're definitely going to make a lot of profit. But if you take a look at, you know, the people I've talked to, especially here in Delaware, I'm sure it's the same around the country, you know, getting a loan to buy a home is extremely difficult. They went from just handing it out with doing absolutely no due diligence whatsoever to you have to jump through 50 million hoops, you know, even if you have good credit, you know, to get a loan. It's very tough. And what also, you know, makes me wonder about, you know, the whole health and people getting money for the, you know, for to buy homes and such, is the QE Infinity that was just introduced by the Federal Reserve. I mean, they're not only going to the tune of $40 billion every single month, finance the federal government through the purchases of Treasury securities, they're actually going to be buying mortgage-backed securities. So they're going to be taking bonds that are fully collateralized by mortgage loans and turning the American people into the financier of the entire mortgage market in the United States. So, I mean, I don't know if they're trying to make a lot of money on it, but it would seem to me that if private industry and mutual fund industry and the hedge fund industry, where there's still a lot of cash floating around, wanted that debt, they'd buy it. And there would be a lot more liquidity in the market. And that doesn't seem to be what's happening here. So I'd be a little skeptical about, you know, buying a lot of these small lending companies thinking they're going to be a big boom, because I'm a little skeptical when I start hearing that the Fed needs to come in and they need to, you know, pump money into the system. And then they talk about that it's going to dump another, what, $1.3, $1.4 trillion. They're thinking they're going to keep it going to mid-2015. Goldman Sachs, you know, they run up almost everything, I think, and, you know, they say it's going to be $2 trillion. When you buy an investment, when you buy an investment like a mortgage-backed security, you're supposed to get your principal back with interest. If it's going to go straight to the debt, they're basically telling you they don't expect to get that money back. So it makes me wonder about the real true health of the mortgage and the housing industry and things of that nature.
Okay, that sounds, like a lot of good things to look into there. I think they're trying to resuscitate it, just kind of like you resuscitate a person. But at the same time, like by 2015, like right now we have about $16 trillion in debt, or that's estimated for the next budget. By 2015, I wonder what our debt's going to be if, you know, the Democrats and Republicans continue to, you know, do things the way they are. And then by that time, you know, what if we have like a 1 or 2% interest rates added on to that?
Well, I don't know. I honestly don't know when you're ever going to see interest rates actually rise. In other words, the Federal Reserve start to increase the rates from about zero from where they are, because they really are, they're caught between a rock and a hard place right now. Because if they do need to raise rates, you know, the amount of debt that we have outstanding and the way it keeps proliferating, I mean, we pay approximately now, last total I saw was about $480 billion a year just on interest of our national debt. And that's at these tremendously low interest rates. If you see interest rates go back up to historical norms of, you know, 5%, 5.5%. You could easily see the interest total to our budget go into the trillions of dollars. And then you're not going to have any money left for, you know, policing the world. And, you know, we all know that Social Security and Medicare and Medicaid.
Well, that's what happened to, like, a lot of countries in South America and all across the world. I mean, we don't want to end up like that, right? So hopefully we have, you know, and people will be looking for alternate solutions. And, like, at least in America here, we have, like, libertarian candidates and Green Party candidates, and it's not like you're finding, like, you know, the Nazi Party or the Communist Party, you know, or too often, at least, as your alternate choice here. We have people who are more qualified, and because they take the you know, their oath to the Constitution seriously. We do have to cut somewhere, and that's the military. I mean, any other thoughts about the budget real quick that you'd want to cover, or finances?
Well, we have to take a look at the domestic side of the equation, too. I mean, we were sold a bill of goods with, you know, the stimulus plan and QE1, that we were going to pump all this money into shovel-ready jobs, and we were going to get people back to work, and it was going to improve our infrastructure. Since 2008, if you look at the federal and state, okay, both, you know, the federal and state expenditures, we've increased our expenditures, you know, about $6.4 trillion. And if you take a look at where the money is going and where it went, if you take a look at government investment, which is where those shovel-ready jobs are, and you adjust it for inflation over that time period, the spending on that particular part of the budget has actually decreased 0.1%. I mean, where we've seen the increases in the budget, of course, is, you know, Medicare and Medicaid, but, you know, also things like, you know, food stamps have increased significantly. I have no problem helping people out, but we're creating a society that's constantly dependent upon, you know, the federal government to take care of them, and subsidizing, you know, companies that shouldn't be subsidized. Green energy, the increased investment from the government on green energy went up like $76 billion.
And growing corn for ethanol, yeah, that's...
For ethanol purchases, or Solyndra, you know, that ends up going bankrupt, that costs $480 million right down the toilet. I mean, we can't continue to do that.
Shouldn't we use industrial hemp, or allow farmers to use that as an option instead of subsidizing corn or, like, many other products? What do you think about that? Should they be able to grow industrial hemp?
Of course. I mean, that's a no-brainer. I mean, we should be able to grow hemp. We should, stop converting corn and putting in ethanol and putting in our tanks and having our food prices go up. I mean, there's no reason that we should be importing hemp-type products from Canada. I mean, we should be growing it here on our farms, letting our farmers, participate in that market and reap the benefits of it.
All right. And what about a woman's right to choose, or pro-life? How do you feel about that issue, sir?
Well, I've softened a little bit over the years. I used to take the very hardcore libertarian position that, you know, no state, local, federal government should tell any woman what they should do with their body. I still believe in a woman's right to choose, but I think, you know, we need to have a cutoff time. We can't have late-term abortions. We can't be doing things that can, hurt the fetus when it can live outside the womb. So I think Roe v. Wade should be overturned. I think I don't think it's a federal issue. I think it's a state issue. And if you turn the issue back over to the states and let them deal with it, I think you're going to find the majority of the states will outlaw abortion, but it'll still be available in some. So so I would say lightly pro-choice on that one.
Okay. Who knows? I mean, there definitely are different circumstances, different trimesters, and all of that. And then how are you going to enforce it, too, is another question. But I know it's a tough subject. And so with the drug war, do you think, we need the DEA and all that, and the kind of the police state that we're living in, civil liberties? What do you think about that?
The drug war is a failure. I mean, we should immediately not only legalize marijuana, not just medicinally like we have in Delaware, but we should legalize it, you know, for recreational use. It makes no sense to me that, you know, you can go down to the local liquor store and you can buy a bottle of scotch and drink that all night, but you can't have one or two marijuana cigarettes and then go to bed. You know, what you do in your home, as long as you're not hurting anybody else, is your own business. Yeah, it's not the government's business. And the funny part is, we tried this before. You know, we back in 1919, we said alcohol was bad. The country said alcohol was bad, and they and they prohibited it. And then they tried it, and they found out it was a complete, utter failure, and they reversed it.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, at least they tried to pass a constitutional amendment for that instead of just, you know, some kind of regulation or some tax stamp act or something like that. What about, or creating a whole, like bureaucracy for it that's, not even constitutional law. So what about for businesses? Like, what do you think tax policy should be? Should we get rid of the income tax and just have a fair tax? Or should we, have a level flat tax? Or what do you think should be the solution there?
Yeah, the federal income tax is not only immoral, it's fundamentally flawed. I mean, it's immoral because it if you accept the idea of an income tax, you're accepting the idea that the federal government owns all of your income and they allowed you to keep a piece, and I don't think that's right. You're entitled to, all your income that you earn. When it comes to corporate tax, I mean, the corporate tax is one of the highest in the world. I think it needs to come down. And we need to replace the federal income tax, get rid of it, and replace it with a national consumption tax. That way, everybody pays, everybody has skin in the game when it comes to the money's going to the federal government. Unfortunately, there's no other way to say this politely. There's a good group of people that don't pay any federal income tax, and they get the services and the benefits. And then there's another group that, if you're fortunate enough to be able to buy a tax lawyer services, you can play the system. You can game the system.
Yeah. So this will actually probably whether immigrant or whatever, everyone pays because they pay when they purchase products, and actually prices would probably settle out because with all the regulations, like Gary Johnson uses can of Coke analogy, where a Coke might cost a dollar, but and so if you put like a sales tax percentage on it, it might cost like $1.50 or whatever, or something like that. But then if you got rid of the income tax and all those regulations and things like that, matching Social Security, Medicare, just having the sales tax take care of all of that, then you would probably reduce their expenditures by 50 cents, so it'd probably equal out to about the same price anyways.
Yeah, I mean, I think there would be a little bit of that going on. I don't think, we're looking at a 50% national consumption tax to solve our problem. I mean, I think, if we taxed everything involved in our gross domestic product, goods and services, we could probably get it somewhere around 10%. And I think if you allow people to keep all of the money that they earn, so you eliminate the federal income tax, you put the power of taxation in the hands of the people.
Totally. I mean, wouldn't that be just insane? I mean, no more federal income tax. I mean, how many, and I think, if you did it for businesses too, I can see nothing but just a wave of businesses heading over here to our shores. I mean, and then long run, I mean, it would almost, that would be, very, very cool. I mean, businesses would just be sprouting up everywhere. We be able to stop him. I mean, I just imagine just you being able to start business and no income tax, no having to register for a lot of different things. Like payroll taxes and all that kind of stuff. I mean, it could just be taken care of with this. And in closing here, I think every business, I mean, what business wouldn't want like something like that? I mean, that would be great. But any closing thoughts? But also, we wanted to ask any people that you've been thinking about lately on your mind. I mean, you are in a campaign, so your thought process, who knows, might be different than it normally has been before. And so any people that you've been thinking about, if you don't mind sharing and why, and then any other final thoughts we might not have mentioned, or any upcoming events, etc., that you'd like to share, Scott.
Well, when you ask me about, what people I've been thinking about, I mean, I've been thinking about the people of Delaware and the people of America in general. And you brought it up in the very outset of this interview that, the National Defense Authorization Act, and the fact that, now the president can order somebody, swept off the street and imprisoned indefinitely and without trial, without counsel, and they could, in theory, ship them off to foreign lands after torturing them for a while, and then blow them up with a drone, with a missile, fire from a drone aircraft. And a lot of people, you tell them this, and they're like, what? And they don't understand, because they're so busy They're so busy just trying to, you know, take care of themselves. They're working two jobs. They're trying to take care of their children because, you know, the economy is a mess, and that's been caused by terrible policy that we've had, that we need to get that message out to them. I want to get my message out to as many people as I can in the state of Delaware so they realize what's going on, that they pay a little bit more attention, and they hold their representatives accountable. And, you know, that's been the whole focus of my campaign. We know what challenges are ahead of us being a third party, especially in a state, you know, like this, where it's very moderate. Candidates are very much the same, and the people seem to be okay with that. But I think when they realize everything that's going on behind the scenes, our message is going to be strong, and people are going to pay a lot more attention to it going forward.
Yeah, let's at least try to change the House of Representatives and maybe the Senate and just change the Congress. I mean, that's kind of a prudent step, but it's something that we can do immediately every 2 years in the House. So it's Gesty, G-E-S-T-Y, the number 4, Congress, C-O-N-G-R-E-S-S.org. If you want to find out more information, GestyForCongress.org. And Scott, thank you so much for this interview, and I know we could probably cover more topics, but they can check them out at that website, and it's really basically very simple. I mean, it's sending a message, but it's also choosing the most qualified candidates. You heard this whole conversation, and I don't think probably even 5 minutes of it you would hear from like a Democrat, Republican. I mean, I think this is what, you know, the founders or founding fathers intended when they're thinking about, you know, local direct representation and having people with our best interests who are informed, and you can hold him accountable too in 2 years. So it's been a pleasure, and I'll say goodbye to you real quick after the interview, but I appreciate your time today, sir.
Thank you very much for having me.